Here's the problem. If you're dealing with a laptop that has its SSD modules soldered directly on the board, once you buy it, you're stuck with whatever storage configuration you chose at the time of purchase. And that's not really an absolutely bad thing per se. It's a trade-off. Yet, the collateral issue of the soldered approach that directly impacts consumers is that you'll need to give in into whatever SSD pricing policy the manufacturer decides upon if you want that specific laptop. And that's a financially very profitable upsell for one company in particular, Apple. This video illustrates what I think are the best workarounds in the form of external storage to this monetary impactful problem. The most proper and scalable solution to this need is an S, and sometimes is the only sensible option for very big storage needs. I wanted to mention this solution first, because I'm not gonna go in depth of this rabbit hole in this video specifically. The scalability, variety, and customization of this type of solution is unmatched and goes far and wide. You can buy an out-of-the-shelf unit or build one yourself. It's, after all, just a purpose-specific configured computer, but all the extra information necessary to make a knowledgeable NAS purchase goes out of the scope of this video. What we need to know if we need to consider a NAS over the external SSD options that are at the core of this video, or perhaps even a simple hard disk, is the following. A NAS with multiple bays has configurable redundancy options, so the data isn't lost even after one or multiple drive fails, depending on the RAID configuration. So there's very little chance to lose data unless the whole NAS gets destroyed. If you have a collaborative production environment, this is naturally the best storage solution because it can be connected simultaneously to multiple computers and grant access to the data to all the people working on the project. A NAS with an appropriate computing power and hardware can be used for more than data storage, as it can host virtual machines, Docker containers, can perform transcoding and function as a Plex server and more. The economics of a NAS start at a pretty high baseline cost, but progressively become better and better the bigger your database is. If you predict your storage needs, allocating for, say, the next 4 years or whatever time frame you think it's reasonable to allocate for, to be less than approximately 10, maybe 15 terabytes at most, and you only need to have convenient access to a couple of terabytes at a time, maybe an NAS is not the preferable solution to an external SSD enclosure that has other benefits that we're gonna discuss in a minute. Finally, an NAS is generally not the most silent, power-efficient, storage-dense, portable, and generally minimal solution for most consumers whose storage needs, again, are more limited in scope and size. In fact, if you're working primarily on a laptop, you probably want to have some sort of portability, and as I mentioned, a NAS hosting several hard drives is not really conveniently portable, and when relocating, some care should be put into preventing the hard drives inside it from being damaged or getting their lifetime shortened by being exposed to vibrations. The option that keeps the portability and simplicity of a laptop relatively intact, and that is also extremely fast, is an external M.2 NVMe SSD enclosure. There are two crucial elements to an M.2 NVMe SSD enclosure to pay attention to: bandwidth and connectivity type. There are several tiers of bandwidth, but basically it's a result of combination of two variables. One is the speed of the enclosure or connection method, and the other is the speed of the M.2 NVMe SSD drive itself that you're gonna put into it. Naturally, the slowest of the two is the determining factor. As for connectivity, if the enclosure only has a Thunderbolt 3 controller, then it can be used only with Thunderbolt 3 ports. In contrast, if the enclosure is a USB one, it's compatible to both Thunderbolt 3 and two regular USB ports. And a bonus gotcha that I'll mention is the drive compatibility. Check that the drive you own or about to buy is an M.2 one and not an M.SATA one, that is effectively another format that is generally not compatible with the M.2 enclosures, and incidentally, M.SATA is also slower, peaking at the 6 gigabit per second SATA-free bandwidth. But before going out and buying the fastest external SSD enclosure just because, stop and ponder for a minute on what do you really need. Because for some uses, bandwidth stops being a bottleneck from a certain point up, and some other aspects like cost, storage density, and compatibility become much more relevant. Therefore, let's see what do we need bandwidth for. For example, considering the use cases that are well suited to an Apple M1 laptop, for the typical consumer, What prompts the need for data storage in the first place is most likely media, and that is usually video, photo, and to a lesser extent, audio. More generally, encompassing all laptops and therefore other use cases, there might be the need to store assets for visual effects and 3D modeling. Furthermore, if the drive is adequately fast, you can also install programs and games on it, and use it as a cache and scratch disks for the programs that require it. If what you need is a digital library where the files ultimately end up, storing completed projects and freeing up space on your internal drive, you really don't need much bandwidth at all. And in this case, the bandwidth only conditions the passive time spent by your computer transferring files. So the solution for those use cases that don't really necessitate a lot of bandwidth, taking the example of photo editing, is either fully embracing the hard drive path and going either for a single hard drive, a RAID-enabled enclosure, or for an S. And today, such hard drives are a very cost-effective solution. Otherwise, go for one of the SSD enclosure options we're about to mention, considering that there is no need whatsoever to excessively overspend for a fast one. Last tip is to also take into consideration the speed of your SD, Compact Flash, CFast or CF Express card and card reader, cause that might be the bottleneck as well. For video editing, I would start by considering the data rate of the footage you work with, which varies greatly as it can start from as low as approximately 50 megabits but even lower for IPB compressed 1080p footage and go as high as thousands of megabits for raw uncompressed footage at higher than 4K resolutions. As you can see, the limit for extremely high data rate raw footage can easily be the record media bandwidth if you have slower type of cards. Still, even the 6K 5:1 BRAW case fits, albeit just barely, into the bandwidth limitations of high-end 3.5-inch 7200 RPM hard disks. So in most cases, what we really get out of an SSD is the almost instant access and wake-up times and generally a lower latency. Yet, in my experience with an external M.2 NVMe SSD with a USB 3.2 Gen 2 enclosure, the occasional brief stutter one might experience before the footage is cached when scrubbing through the timeline to a new video file is still encounterable. Perhaps this is caused in this case by the device's controller's handshake or some other USB latency limitations, but in practice it's more of a nitpick than an actual annoyance, and it really is a no issue. The bottom line is that any of the SSD enclosures that we're gonna mention has likely enough bandwidth to handle pretty high data rates that are sufficient for all but very high-level productions. What you're really getting is possibly some performance benefit if you're using the drive for cache and as a scratch disk, but don't necessarily bet that the performance difference to be that noticeable for your case. So while it's true that the higher the bandwidth, the better, it's very hard to know without experimenting at what point the performance benefit stops being noticeable for your particular workflow. Worst case scenario though, if you go a little bit overkill, is that you're just spending a little bit more for benefits that aren't really appreciable. I will give you my advice in function of the enclosure prices and my personal qualitative experience, and I'm gonna share with you what I believe is the optimal cutoff point where one should stop considering higher bandwidth options. Finally, regarding the SSD drive itself, if you'll be using it as a scratch and cache disk, I highly recommend you to get a TLC or triple layer cell SSD, mainly because they have a higher data writing endurance compared to QLC. With that in mind, we are now ready to go through the external SSD options from highest to lowest bandwidth. The highest bandwidth options are enclosures for M.2 PCIe-free NVMe drives, and that's a very desirable drive form factor in my opinion. Yes, the enclosures are a little bit more expensive than a less than $10 SATA to USB adapter cable, but in my view the M.2 form factor is the most optimal choice for more than one reason. The fastest M.2 NVMe enclosures are the ones that use a Thunderbolt 3 controller that makes use of all the 4 lanes of PCIe-free available to the port. What's the main problem with those? In my opinion, the pricing for that type of enclosure is just too much. Paying in the ballpark of $150 for the enclosure alone is not worth it unless you're absolutely sure you can make use of that bandwidth for your applications. The next step down is the EC, T3 and S enclosure by Sabrent, having a street price of around $90. It is still Thunderbolt 3, yet the controller used is the Intel Alpine Ridge JHL6240, and that one uses only 2 out of the 4 PCI lanes, and as a result, the enclosure is rated at 1600 MB per second. A great thing is that the Intel controllers are very efficient and the TDP for this one is only 1.2 watts, and that should result in cooler enclosure temperatures compared to the following options. But before that, a small detail is that the cable and enclosure have an indentation that doesn't allow you to use other Thunderbolt cables unmodified. That's probably to prevent people from using random USB Type-C cables that don't support Thunderbolt 3 speeds and consequently lamenting performance. I repeat myself saying that the big gotcha with this one, as most of the Thunderbolt 3 enclosures, is that it's not compatible with normal USB ports, and therefore its potential use as a high-speed, high-capacity big USB drive is not super convenient due to a narrower compatibility. Anyway, if you're using a Mac and decide to format the drive as Apple File System or macOS Extended, which are in my view preferable to exFAT, for example because DaVinci doesn't let you create a database on exFAT formatted drives, compatibility with regular USB devices is in this case irrelevant anyway, since all modern Macs have Thunderbolt 3, so there would be no compatibility advantages to a USB 3.2 Gen 2 enclosure. So if you don't care about Windows compatibility, or you do and you're fine with exFAT, but only have Thunderbolt 3 devices around, I think this enclosure is a very nice option. Yet, the bandwidth improvement over a 10 gigabit per second USB 3.2 Gen 2 is not that massive, and it's up to you to decide if this extra speed along with the efficiency and reliability of an Intel chipset is worth the extra price compared to our next options. Stepping down into the 10 gigabit per second USB realm, after reading a 27-page discussion on the AnandaTech forum over SSD enclosures, I gather quite a great deal of useful information that I'm gonna summarize for your convenience. Probably the most important component in an enclosure to pay attention to is the controller. And there are prevalently only 3 controllers options in the USB M.2 SSD enclosures found in the market. There are many bad opinions regarding the one from Micron. Yes, it's the cheapest, but it's very power hungry, therefore the enclosure gets pretty hot and as a consequence it might in some cases thermal throttle, hindering performance. The likelihood of that happening is dependent on the temperature of your environment, but on top of that, and really most importantly, it seems to be unstable with random disconnects happening. No need to say more, the enclosures with the Micron JMS 583 controller are to avoid. The other 2 controllers are fortunately good, and it doesn't really matter too much which one you go for. The Realtek RTL9210 seems to be a hair more efficient and even slightly faster than the S-Media ISM2362, that seems to be super stable, although quite power hungry. I personally ended up with an ISM2362 equipped enclosure, and I haven't experienced a single disconnect so far in 4 months of intermittent use, although I can confirm that during video editing, while the drive is being constantly stressed, since I'm not only editing out of it, but also using it for cache and as a scratch disk, it gets pretty hot, with the surface temperature being in the same ballpark as the top of the MacBook Air for reference. So this is our next option. Incidentally, it's the one I personally use, the Asus Strix Arion 10 gigabit per second USB 3.2 Gen 2 enclosure. The only major problem with it is the RGB, that can't be turned off when using it with a Mac, not even after connecting it to a Windows PC and disabling it through the Asus Armoury Crate software. I don't really know why the RGB plague has so flamboyantly infiltrated the accessories market, but if you can't turn it off, you can agree that it's annoying if you sleep in the same room of the drive and your only option is to turn off the Mac instead of leaving it in sleep mode. Although I'm not super mad about it, because at least here it's not even so badly implemented as it complements the enclosure's cyberpunk look. I still think that a more elegant and functional RGB-free look would be generally preferable, especially considering the extra power consumption that for a portable device is not really something desirable, and that the LED energy that is not radiated as light ends up as heat, possibly contributing in a non-negligible measure to the enclosure temperatures. And to complete the quick and passant review, the accessories, with the exception of the very useful inclusion of both USB Type-C to USB Type-C and USB Type-C to USB Type-A cables, are otherwise pure environmental waste, such as the quote-unquote bumper that is not even made of soft rubber but plastic and does not even properly protrude, protecting the front and bottom of the enclosure, and which only function is trapping the heat that could be otherwise irradiated by the sides with an insulating material. And do I need to mention a clip? Finally, I'm not really a fan of the seam extractor operated opening mechanism. It's flimsy, but it works, I guess. Still, I think this is a very solid option, and in my opinion, for cash and scratch discs, you're likely looking either at this one or at the aforementioned Sabrent EC-T3NS. The Asus is slightly cheaper and it's compatible to all USB devices, again granted that you formatted it with XFAT. On the other hand, the Sabrent is marginally faster and has a more efficient Intel controller. The fact check evaluation of the Sabrent is approximately $30 over the Asus, that basically accounts for the better controller and the higher rated Thunderbolt cable. And that's pretty in line with their street prices, so as far as value, they're pretty similar to my judgment. Moving on, the Realtek RTL9210 alternative options have the potential to be generally equally good to the Asus, yet the ones I've seen generally have a lower dissipating surface, that to be fair might be counterbalanced by an allegedly more efficient controller, but still the build quality seems to be generally worse than the Asus. Stepping down the bandwidth ladder, if you wouldn't benefit of the approximately 1 GB per second data rate of those M.2 enclosures for your use cases, and if you want to repurpose the SATA 2.5-inch SSDs that you already own, you can do it with an approximately $10 SATA to USB 3.0 adapter. But I wouldn't take this approach if I needed to purchase new drives unless my budget was really limited, because I would then be stuck with what I feel is a less flexible drive format going into the future. So the main disadvantage, in my opinion, to this approach is not only that the bandwidth gets cuts at the 5 gigabit per second theoretical maximum of USB 3.0, because if the attached drive can keep up, this is still a pretty wide bandwidth for a lot of use cases, but also that NVMe M.2 drives have notoriously higher random inputs-outputs per second, and are significantly better for random read and writes of small chunks of data. All this might prove beneficial for certain IOPS intense workloads, so while the option to go for SATA SSDs is overall one that's a little bit cheaper than the NVMe M.2 solutions, mainly because of the higher cost of the M.2 enclosure compared to the simple and cheap SATA to USB adapter cable, the takeaway is that with the current prices, unless you already own a couple of SATA drives that you want to put to use, I don't think it's worth the savings. So the next option is a high performance hard drive. Leaving out RAID enclosures that have multiple drives, this solution further cuts the sustained transfer speeds that, in this case, assessed at around 200 megabytes per second, but in return, it massively improves the gigabyte of storage per dollar metric. You can either buy a high-performance 3.5-inch 7200 RPM standalone drive and connect it with a SATA to USB 3 adapter that in this case has to accept power delivery from a compatible power brick, or go for one of the various off-the-shelf solutions. The extra power delivery is necessary in both cases, since USB can't power 3.5-inch drives, so this adds a little bit of clutter to the setup. The steps down from here are going to be a slower 5400 RPM 3.5-inch drive, and then, if your needs are super basic and budget is the main concern, you might go for slower and smaller 2.5-inch hard drives. You can tell an enclosure employs a 2.5-inch drive if it doesn't need external power other than the USB port, which incidentally certainly benefits portability and simplicity of setup. So there you have it, hopefully you now know what's the best storage solution for you. If you're interested in other computer-related in-depth first principle-based analysis that seek to find the optimal purchase in function of your specific use cases, needs and preferences, check out the other videos on the channel and subscribe for future videos. But for now, dear intellectuals, thanks for watching and never make a suboptimal purchase again.